Hey folks, so this is going to be my entries into the Warts and All Facebook groups PTO and Far East group build of World War II. That's going to be, I guess it's going to run until June the 1st until December 1st of this year. So it's a pretty simple process. If you want to join the group build, you have to join the Facebook group, the link of which is in the description in the video below. The link actually to the Warts and All Facebook group is always in the description of all my videos. So if you want to join, it's always there. So to join the group, simple process. You answer the questions three, agree to the rules, and I strongly suggest you read the rules because they're pretty specific. And most of them are what I believe to be common sense, and we all know that common sense isn't as common as you might think, but I would like to think that a lot of these would be. And it's basically have some manners, don't be a fuck knuckle, and away you go. Now, you know, it's being a fuck knuckle is like one of those things, like crazy people generally don't know they're crazy. They think the rest of the world is crazy and they're getting saner. Being a fuck knuckle, there's a good chance that you may not know you're a fuck knuckle, but that's okay. I'm pretty good at spotting them, and it's pretty obvious. Most fuck knuckles, their Facebook profile is just completely covered in fuck knuckleness, so it's pretty obvious, and we're just not going to let you in. So if you don't get in, that's why. It's because you're a fuck knuckle. or you didn't answer the questions and agree to the group. You have to agree to the rules and answer the questions. There's check boxes, you know, and you got to actually enter answers to all three questions. You got to have a profile picture. Otherwise, Facebook will auto block you or auto dismiss you. Anyway, not block you. There's a couple other stipulations too that Facebook automatically adds just to keep spammers out. So it's a pretty simple process. Or at least I thought it was until a moment ago. Now it sounds like it's pretty complicated. So maybe you don't want to do it. But anyway, so the group build, like I said, goes from June the 1st till December the 1st of this year. And it's basically the PTO and Far East. So if you don't know what that means, PTO is Pacific Theater of Operations during the Second World War. So it covers basically from when Japan invaded China all the way until Japan surrendered to the Allies in 1945 of August. So that's a really long period of time with an enormous number of events. You have a huge topic base there. So there's so many different things. I mean, you could pick almost anything out of your stash and build it for a lot of things, for a lot of different guys, especially fellows that are aircraft guys. I'm pretty sure they have almost anything in their stash. Armor guys are a bit more limited. There's not a lot of armor options for, PTO. Unless you're doing Far East. Far East, there's a bit more because the British use armor. The Australians, they didn't really have any armor there at all. They kept it mostly at home. I can't remember if New Zealand had any there or not. I'd have to actually look that up. They might have had some Valentines there, but I'm not sure. So I know that the British Indian Army, they were using the Grants, and they had the Stuarts there and stuff. But they were pretty limited. The Marines were using quite a bit of armor, and the U.S. Army were using quite a bit of armor too, but nowhere near the amount that they were using in Europe. So, but there are still options. But trying to find the specific kits is a bit more challenging for armor guys because there's not a lot to pick from. Now I'm hoping to build three different entries. This, believe it or not, is only two. This is one entry and this is the second entry. I have a third entry that I'd like to get to if these two get done. So my first one is going to be this one. And this one here I've had planned to get done to build for a long, long time. It's actually been on my list of builds. Holy shit. Almost 3 years now. I just haven't got to it. This kit here, this Hellcat, Edward Hellcat, it's my favorite kit of aircraft that I've ever built. I love this kit. I'm not a huge aircraft guy. I haven't built a lot of aircraft. And it's because I struggle with them. They're not the easiest things to build for a lot of different reasons, and I won't go into them. You know, anyone who builds aircraft knows what the challenges are, and anyone who doesn't build aircraft and they have built a couple, you know what they are too. If you've never built an aircraft before, well, I suggest you try one. You'll find out. They're not like armor at all. They're not like cars. They're not like sci-fi. Actually, they're a bit more like sci-fi and a bit more like cars than they are armor. So they're a different animal. I like building aircraft because of the challenges they present, but there's a lot that I just find irritating about them. But I'm trying to get over that. This kit went a long way into helping with that because it was such a joy to build. It's not like a Tamiya kit. I find Tamiya kits boring as fuck because you literally just shake the box and dump it on the thing and sprinkle some glue on it and it's built. Most Tamiya kits I can build in an hour. All right. I hate that in a kit. I don't want to build a kit that I spent $50 on in an hour. I want it to take days or weeks, even months to build. I want it to have hundreds of thousands of tiny little fucking parts that don't fall apart when I touch them and don't go pinging across the room into a million little pieces. I want a well-engineered, well-fitted kit that has lots and lots of parts and an interesting but not overly complex build sequence. Tamiya doesn't do that. Tamiya is too simple. The detail is too smudged. It's too flat. And they're just boring and they're too expensive for what you're paying for. And that's why I don't like Tamiya. Now, I know there are a lot of people out there that really, really, really like Tamiya, and I'm not saying that you shouldn't. If you really like Tamiya, then you really like Tamiya, and you have your reasons to like them, and they're all valid. My valids for disliking Tamiya are just as valid. I'm allowed to dislike them, and you are allowed to like them. There, argument is over. No more discussion necessary. So, anyway, this kit is like my idea of what a Tamiya kit should be. It has lots and lots of parts, really, really good fits, and has great detail and easy to read instructions. It's like, fuck, huh? Where have you been all my life? And so for an aircraft kit to do that and to serve someone like me who's got really kind of specific tastes when it comes to building kits, it was wonderful. I couldn't have asked for a better aircraft kit for a guy like me. So I loved it. And it not only was that served, there are two kits in this one box. So you get two models for the price of one. And it was literally for the price of one. I think I paid like $65. And that was not that long ago, right, for this kit. This kit's probably a lot more than that now. But it was a really, really good deal. So I was super impressed with this. And I fell in love with it. And I've been holding on to it for this specific type of situation. So I'm looking forward to building this because I enjoyed the last one so much. Now, what I'm going to do with it is it's either going to be an aircraft carrier deck, which is going to be a whole new challenge for me because I've never built anything like that. A wooden deck with metal fittings and stuff like that, with paint lines and everything. It's going to be totally bizarre and strange. It's going to take me a while to figure out how to do that. It'll be cool. I've got the supplies to do it. I just got to know how to do it. So that's going to be fun. And if that doesn't quite go according to plan, if I discover that I can't do it, then it's going to be ground-based and it'll be an aircraft being serviced by this truck, the fuel truck. Now, if I discover, because I haven't done any research on this topic at all yet, if I discover that these trucks existed on aircraft carriers, which I can see is a possibility, but I don't think they did. I'm not sure. Then I'm going to combine the three elements together, the aircraft deck, the truck, and the aircraft. And that would really make me happy. But I don't think that they did. They didn't use them on the aircraft. It just strikes me as odd having a truck on an aircraft carrier. But that doesn't mean that it didn't happen. It just means that I find a hard time imagining it. So, anyway, that's my idea with that. I haven't explored this yet. And funny thing is, this is going to be my first build, but I'm doing the research for this one. I don't know why I'm doing that. So anyway, this is the second build. It's going to be the conflict, which I can't remember the name of right now, because I only just started reading it this morning, Beings with an Eye. It's happened between Japan and British forces, British Indian forces on the border between Burma and India. And it's actually a successful battle between the British, defeating the Japanese forces, because it was not the best well-planned or led invasion attempt by Japan. Just reading about it just this morning, the guy who envisioned the entire operation in Japan was a bit of a fuck knuckle. That guy, definitely a fuck knuckle. So this is going to be an interesting one, because I've never built that type of terrain before. It's supposed to be really hilly, mountainous-ish type terrain, right? Rough terrain, with armor, which at the time, everyone thought that armor wouldn't work in that type of terrain, but the British managed to make it work really, really well and whoop some big ass. So it'll be fun to do this scene, because this is going to be a captured Japanese M3. Now, I haven't done the research on the M3 yet to find out if this variant of the M3 was the one that they had. It might have been a different one. And I have another one downstairs that I might have to use. So I haven't done the research on that yet. So this kit might get replaced with a different one. And so this is going to be a British Indian grant. So it'll be a mountainous scene either that's going to be knocked out and this is going to be in the picture, or the other way around, where the Grant is knocked out and the Japanese tank is like doing something in the picture. I haven't envisioned the diorama layout yet, but that's the theme. One is knocked out and the other one is not. So one will have like fire damage and everything, which is always an adventure trying to do that. And the other one will be, doing its job. I haven't decided on figures yet. I haven't decided on exact orientation of the story that I'm trying to tell yet. I've got the rough idea. So, like I said, I'm still doing the research on the elements to know how I can tie them all together. This one's much more simple. So that's where I'm going with those. The third thing that I want to do is I have this diorama that I did for another group build. I was never really happy with how it turned out. It's very sloppy, and I rushed it, and I was never happy with it. I want to revisit it. I want to take it all apart and redo it so that it matches closely this other diorama that I have, and I want to be able to tie the two of them together into a combined scene without taking apart the original diorama that I really like. That one's going to stay pristine because I really like that one, and I want to make a new diorama that matches it, that tells it, expands on the story using the elements from the one I'm going to scrap. So that's my plan if I have time. That diorama is not on my shelf right now. It's downstairs collecting dust in my storage room because it was actually going to be scrapped and tossed out. Instead of tossing it, I want to try and rebuild it and see what I can do with that. So that's my plan. So it's hopefully three different pieces will get done out of this, and one will be a restoration, I'm hoping. So that's my idea. Now it doesn't start until June the 1st, which is about 3 weeks from now almost. So until then, I'm still working on the N-scale layout that my son and I are working out, the train railroad layout, which is proving to be a fascinating challenge. One of the things that I love about scale modeling in all of its facets, and I don't care what it is you do, if it's, figures, it's sci-fi, it's railroad modeling, aircraft, cars, ships, dollhouse, even just standalone dioramas that are not related to anything, right? Doesn't matter what it is. It's how much you can learn from doing the same thing just in a different way, right? I'm a dioramist. So dioramists, the skill set you have in dioramists, because you use plastic models incorporated into your dioramas, it tends to have a big, it's like a universal translator. The world of dioramas tends to be a universal translator in the hobbies, because you bring together so many different disciplines from all the different genres together to make a diorama. you tend to speak all the different languages of the other genres. Where if you just stick to cars, or you just stick to figures, or you just stick to railroad layouts tend to be a bit more expansive because they're like big dioramas. But I've discovered there are some limitations, actually a lot of limitations to it, and a lot of guys tend to have a bit of tunnel vision too. And then there's, you know, sci-fi guys that just build sci-fi stuff. They don't quite realize that there's a lot of products in like other genres that are just as applicable in their own that they've never even knew it existed. Like a simple example, I use a decal solution called Walther's Solvacet, and I've been using it for years and years and years. And I only use that because I tried using other decal solutions and I didn't really much like them. Right, either there were too many parts to it, like too many different chemicals, or they were too strong, or they weren't strong enough, or they were really hard to get, or they were expensive. You know, there was just a lot of different reasons I didn't like them. And then I discovered Walther's Solvacet at my local hobby shop. Now my local hobby shop is mostly remote control and train layout stuff. There is modeling stuff there too, but it isn't their main focus. It tends to be mostly like train layouts. There's a whole section in the back of the store. It's just all train stuff and train supplies. And that's where I found the Solvacet, because that's Walther's. That's what they mostly make. They make products for train layouts. So I tried this decal solution and I loved it. I couldn't believe how universal it was. It worked on all the decals that I had, including Tamiya decals, which are notoriously awful. And I just kept using it, and I continue to use it. I mean, and it comes in a great big bottle, so it lasts a really long time. And the first bottle I bought cost like $5.99. This is Canadian money, by the way. And the next bottle I bought like 8 years later cost $10.99. And now I'm almost out of that, and I have to buy another one. So it's probably going to cost me $20 for the new bottle because it keeps going up by like 10 bucks each pop. So, but anyway, the annoying part is it's notoriously hard to buy it online. There's not a lot of places to stock it online because it's a railroad product. It's not as prolific around. I mean, if you want like Microsol or something like that, you can find that anywhere. You can shake a tree, it probably falls out. But I don't like that stuff. I mean, there's all kinds of new ones out there too that come in like different strengths and stuff like that. Again, too complicated. I want something that's a single product, single use, single application, simple as hell. And Walther's always solves that for me. So that's why I keep buying it. But in order for me to get it, means I have to get my wife to drive, because I don't drive a car. I haven't driven a car since 2001 and I don't plan on changing that. And there's a good reason why I don't drive a car, but I'm not going to talk about that. And it's not because I did anything stupid. I'm not a criminal. I didn't have my driver's license taken away or lose my license or anything. But anyway, so I have to get my wife to drive me all the way into the city, which is a 45-minute trip each way, right? And then she has to sit in the van while I go into a model shop because she has zero interest in going in there. We have to drag my two kids with us because they're too young to stay home alone. And then I have to go in there, buy exactly what I want, and come back out. I can't linger or shop around or anything like that. All just to buy one bottle of decal solution, right? Because there's not much in there that I would need that I can't buy online for a lot less. So the trip is kind of an awkward and annoying one. So it's not one that happens very often. Actually, the last time I was in the city to buy anything from a model shop was probably 3 years ago. And I think, no, it was 5 years ago. Yeah, it was 5 years ago because it was when I bought that last bottle of Walther's Solvacet. So it doesn't happen very often. And I try to avoid it when I can. It's not because I don't want to support my local hobby shop. It's just I don't really have a local hobby shop. It's 45 minutes away each way, right? It takes half the day to go and get it. It's not something I do. It's just faster and easier for me to order everything online. And it tends to be cheaper. But again, like some people, I don't have access to everything online, and some things you have to actually go and buy. Most of it I can get away with at a craft store. There's a craft store not far away and I can get some things there that work for me. So, you know, this wonderful world we live in where we got all kinds of different fellows out there that they're blessed with having access to like clubs or big model shows that they can go to, or crafts or hobby stores that are like, you know, three or four of them all around them and stuff like that. And I got to tell you, I'm envious of that. I mean, I haven't been to a model show. The only model show that I've ever been to, my local one, right? And it's very small. And I haven't been to it in years. Well, recently because of COVID. And before that, because they changed how the thing operates, and I don't have any interest in going anymore. It used to be really inclusive for kids, right? And it used to be peer judged, and the kids liked to get in on the voting and stuff. They don't do that anymore. Now it's just a bunch of old people that are dusty, old farts that just are there for the awards and stuff. And they don't want the kids voting because they think it skews the results. The results are fun. That's the result. And they seem to have missed that point. Anyway, so myself and my kids don't have any interest in going anymore because they've been excluded. And I think they have every right to feel excluded by it. So we don't go anymore. And plus, it's also a really long drive to get there. It's on the far side of the city from where I am. And it's like an hour and a half to get there and an hour and a half to get back. And, you know, we aren't big people who like to drive everywhere for small reasons. We'll go for family trips, you know, to go camping and stuff. That's one thing. But just to go like buy a bottle of decal solution, or just to go for an hour or two at a model show. No, we just don't do that. So, yep. So, you know, and I also live in a desert when it comes to model shops. There's one, two actually, but they're, like I said, they're in the city, 45 minutes each way that way. So we don't go there. I don't have any model clubs around me. There's none at all. I would love to have a model club. That'd be cool. So my only interaction with modelers is online. That's it. But I know a lot of guys that are like that. That's the only way they have any interaction, right? They spend all their time when they're doing the modeling in their cave, talking to people on some kind of digital media. That's the only thing that they have. And I've been like that right from the beginning. So I wouldn't know what to do, actually, if I joined a model club. I'd be like a awkward poodle, like my dog. My dog is an awkward poodle. He's like a total nerd when he's around other dogs. He doesn't know what to do. You should see him. He's a socially awkward poodle. I'd be the same way. All right. I just wouldn't know what to do because I'd be so excited. I'd be tripping over myself because I have never been to a club before. You know, even going to the model show, I get all jazzed and everything because I never get to see it. Even though it's a tiny little thing, right? You know, very small model show. It's still exciting. I don't know. I'd probably have a stroke if I went to a great big show like the one in Toronto. But I can't go to that one. It's 1,400 kilometers away, right? It's a three-day drive just to get there. And it's pretty sad when it's a three-day drive just to get there and it's still in your own country. That's like driving from like Bavaria to Moscow. To give you an idea, it's like that. I think that's like 14 hours. Actually, that might not even be that far. I'm not sure. But anyway, so I envy folks that have access to that. It'd be something that I wish existed around here. I've asked around to see if there's anyone who is into scale modeling of any kind around here. There's nothing. Nobody. Most of them don't even know what it is. So I'm pretty much the only one here that does this sort of thing. Everybody who knows me here knows what I do because they see this shit on Facebook and stuff. But there's nobody around here. I did recently discover that a guy that I went to high school with that I never knew he was into this, he's a scale modeler. And he joined the Facebook group, the Warts and All Facebook group. And I think he didn't even know that I was helping to run, the Facebook group. And I recognized his name. I'm like, holy shit, is this you? And he's like, yeah, it's me. I was like, holy crap, I didn't know you were into scale models. So, but he's not very active. But, you know, it was cool to see that at least somebody I knew outside of the digital world, anyway, was a scale modeler. That was kind of cool. But he also lives about 200 kilometers away, so I'm not going to be able to see him on a regular basis. Anyway, blah, 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 blah. That was a whole lot of pointless chatter about absolutely nothing that has anything to do with what I wanted to talk about, which was this. So these are my entries. that's the group build. If you want to join, you know what to do because I've already talked about it. And that's all I got. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.